Hey guys, what's up? Welcome back to my channel. I hope you all are doing really well. Today's video is going to be a Q&A. You guys got the questions, I got the answers today. This type of video is so long overdue. I posted over on my Instagram stories a little question box where you guys could ask me anything and everything. If you guys are not already following me over on Instagram, pause for a second, go make sure you are. My handle is at @IamCarissaRenee. So should we just go ahead and get started? First question, Carissa, are you long-winded? Why, yes I am. So let's see how many questions I could get through. Go grab a snack. Go grab a meal, go grab a glass of wine. We might be here for a while. I feel like this is gonna be a long video, but let's just go ahead and dive on in. Let's start with a super easy question. How old are you? So I am 31 years old. My birthday is at the end of May, where I'll be 32. But yep, I honestly cannot believe it. I am 31. Lots of questions on my career and school as well. What did you go to school for? And was your degree worth it for what you're doing now? What do you do for a living, aside from being an influencer, of course? What do you do for Amazon? What do you do for a living? Or is YouTube your main job? So definitely a lot of questions around that. So I'll go ahead and just dive into it. So I went to school at Washington State University, go Cougs. I studied management information systems directly out of school, and for the next 5 or 6 years, I was actually in recruiting. I was first at a staffing company, and then I went over to Amazon. A part of my responsibilities at the staffing company is I was in charge of managing the Amazon account, and through that, I ended up building a lot of relationships with a few hiring managers over at Amazon. And I actually got approached by a hiring manager over at Amazon that was hiring for recruiters. So that's how I ended up actually getting my job over at Amazon. I was mostly within the AWS umbrella of the company. Apart from like 1 year, I think my entire time at Amazon, I've actually been under AWS. So I guess I should say in total at Amazon, I've been there for almost 7 years now. In June will be 7 years. And like I said, for the first 3 years or so, I was actually in recruiting. And part of, towards the end of my recruiting career, part of the things that I was responsible for was a lot of organizing events. So for the last year, I think, of my recruiting job at Amazon, I was traveling all over the world for different recruiting events, and I pretty much organized and started this business sourced events. And so I was working really closely with the businesses that I was recruiting for, like their teams. And we put together like these major events where we would interview sometimes 30 to 60 people, and I'd be like the main person responsible for organizing and running the whole thing, you name it. And so when I started to become more grounded and I stayed in Seattle and I didn't travel outside of Seattle, I was responsible for diversity recruiting events just in the Seattle area. So whether that just be women in engineering, for example, I would organize events where we would interview women in tech. It's very windy outside. I apologize if you can hear it. But I would also organize panel events as well, where just women in tech can meet with other women and get questions answered, especially across all sorts of levels and job positions too. It was really fun. But essentially, a part of that, that's where I got recognized by a director for all of the work that I was doing, and he wanted me to come over to his team to be a program manager. And it was kind of funny because obviously my degree is in management information systems, which is more closely aligned with being a technical program manager, a business analyst sort of a career. And so while nerve-wracking it was to switch careers, I couldn't pass up on the opportunity. So I interviewed for being a program manager and switching over to this team. And that's where I've been ever since. I am a program manager for a team in AWS. I work with a development team, so my job is very technical. I'm responsible for a lot of different things as being a program manager on my specific team. Part of like my main job is our release program, so a tons of launches and releasing our product and getting updates out to customers. But there's also a lot of other programs in my job that I'm responsible for too. Our infrastructure budget is one of them, and a lot of operations types of programs as well. So it's definitely been a wild ride. It's been super fun, and yeah, I love it. I'm still growing there. I'm on course for being promoted, so cross our fingers that happens in the next year or so. And I guess what you can kind of see through my career, which is interesting realization is you never know who's watching, what opportunities might open up, you know? So always make sure that you are performing at your best. If I wasn't, I don't know if I ever would have gone to Amazon if this manager was interested in me and loved what she saw and would have wanted me on her team. And same with this director, looking at how I organize programs and how structured I am with all that, that he would bet on me and want me to be a part of his team and help his team grow, you know? So always make sure that you are performing at your best. And then I guess a little over a year ago is when I started my journey here on YouTube. So that's another question that I'm gonna segue into is, how did you get started on YouTube? I love your channel. Thank you so, so, so much. It's kind of like a weird journey, I feel like, because I don't know if any of you guys have scrolled deep enough in my Instagram, but back in 2015, so over the years, I've kind of dabbled with this sort of world. Back then, I was very much in the makeup and the beauty space. I used to be so obsessed with makeup, you guys, like insane, and I'm definitely not to that level anymore. I kind of have like a one face, and that's pretty much all the makeup that I wear. I used to have like buckets and drawers of makeup. But anyways, it's funny, just like throughout the years, you definitely doubt yourself, and there's so much time and effort that goes into this that I don't know if people really realize. And then also the other aspect that I really fought with was putting myself out there. Like, something to know about me is I'm actually pretty much an introvert. There's times that I am an extrovert, especially if I'm in like social situations. I feel like I have to like be on, you know what I mean? So I definitely can be extroverted in some scenarios, but when I come home, I'm like exhausted and I just like wanna be by myself, homebody, like watch TV. So I'm very much like not a super social person. And so putting your life out there was difficult to do. And even now, I don't think it was up until maybe 4 months ago that I even told my family that I was doing YouTube. It wasn't something that I was embarrassed of by any means, because this has been such a fun outlet for me. The reasons that I want to do it is because I love sharing my passion for beauty and fashion with all of you guys, and I love this community that we've built too. Like, I love the connections that you and I have built. So it's been so fun, and everything like behind the scenes, I love to organizing all the content, figuring out exactly like what I want to do, when I want to do it, styling everything, even the vlogs. Like, I love all of that. I even love like the editing part of it, the photography. I just feel like this is such a creative outlet for me that I don't currently have in my job. And I'm definitely a creative person, so it's been really fun for me to like flex this muscle a little bit for me. But I guess what I'm trying to get at is that there really isn't a perfect time to start. Just start, you know what I mean? Like, that's what held me back for so long, is just, I don't know, maybe people's opinions or putting myself out there. But if it's something that you truly enjoy doing and you love all those things that I was mentioning, you're gonna find such happiness in this area too. So I'm definitely so happy I did it. And I guess that's kind of how like I got started. I just decided in January of last year that I was like, you know what? This is a time, no better time than being what, 30 years old to like follow my dreams and like what I truly want to do. So I set goals for myself of being consistent and you name it. And I was like, we're gonna do this. We're gonna make it happen. So I'm very, very happy that I did. Some weeks are hard to manage both jobs. I'm not gonna lie about that, but I wouldn't give up any of this for the world. So if you guys are looking to start a YouTube channel, just do it. There is space for every single person, is what I realized. This is so cheesy to say, but just be you, be yourself, be authentic, and you'll go super far. A question on if you're going to make a video on your Invisalign journey. So yes, of course I am. I announced on Instagram yesterday that I got all like the little attachments on my teeth taken off, and I'm in the home stretch, you guys. I have like 2 weeks left of Invisalign, and mostly that's just another appointment to get like new scans done to get fitted for like my retainer, and then I'm getting my retainer and then I'm done. So once I'm officially done, I will of course film like a separate video on my full journey for everyone that is interested. And the reason why I want to wait until I'm done is because I want to show you guys before and afters too. So that is definitely coming. Lots of questions about good old Juan. How did we meet? How long have you guys been dating? Good old Juan. So Juan and I have been dating for 4.5 years now. I think we met about 5.5 years ago. No surprise here, we actually met through Amazon. So remember when I was talking about my time at Amazon when I was a recruiter? So he is a software engineer and he was on the team that I was recruiting for. He was also someone that went on a lot of the trips that I went on too, because of course the business has to travel as well as the recruiting team to, you know, they're the faces, they're the ones that are doing all of like the interviews with all of the candidates. And so yeah, we traveled a ton together and we just became really best friends. And then eventually over time, we just started dating, which is just kind of wild. And I guess the rest is history. Lots of questions around my breast augmentation as well. If I was comfortable sharing it, and if I was, just how was the overall experience and if I experienced any complications. So my breast augmentation was almost 4 years ago. In August, it'll be 4 years. My experience wasn't all like rainbows and butterflies by any means. And I'm not saying this to scare you guys if you guys are interested in getting breast augmentation. So let me explain more. So this is definitely something that I've always wanted done. If there was just one thing that I wanted to change about myself, it was that. It was something that I was dreaming about since I was like a teenager. But it's kind of funny because through the years, I kind of just put it off because of, well, what if I get married? What if I have kids or that sort of stuff? Then I'm just gonna have to get another breast augmentation to like fix it. And I just kept putting off for that reason. And one day I was like, you know what? I need to live life for me. I don't know if and when those things are gonna happen. I wanna enjoy life now in the present. So I went ahead and got my breast augmentation. Of course, if you know me, I'm a very data-driven person. I'm a researcher, that's what I love to do. So I did tons of research on this. I went to multiple different surgeons. I interviewed them. I came prepared with tons of questions. I asked the ins and outs of everything. I really knew how many CCs I wanted to get. I knew the look I wanted, just everything, right? And so I dived in, I made the appointment, I went for it. Coming out of surgery was wild. So it was the first time that I've ever went under with anesthesia ever in my life. And I loved it, you guys. Like, it just felt like an amazing nap. You know, you dream, all like that sort of stuff. And all of a sudden someone's like, hey, Krissa, like wake up sort of a thing. It's wild to even think of. And like the volume and everything to keep like, I don't know, I was just so calm. I was pretty good. So my initial recovery was great as well. Obviously it takes a lot of time to recover. I don't know if this is accurate anymore, but when I was looking into it, they were saying like, oh yeah, like a week and a half, you should be totally fine. Sort of thing. For me, my recovery was a lot longer. I think it was like 2-2.5 weeks until I felt like okay. So definitely, if you are interested in it, plan for a longer recovery than what you think, because everybody's body is very different from one another, you know? So for me also, I did end up having some complications. One of my breasts ended up bottoming out. No fault to the surgeon at all. It was actually just my anatomy and the way that my breast was structured. And so he had to go back in and fix it. Unfortunately, this took 2 times. And so over the course of like 1.5 years, because you want to give space in between each of the surgeries for the scar tissue to build and for you to heal, of course, and you don't want to go under the knife like so frequent, you know? So there's time in between all of like these surgeries, but I did have to go in twice to correct the same breast for it bottoming out. It is now fixed and everything is super great. But what I wanted to get at is, if you are interested in doing a breast augmentation, don't let those sort of things scare you. I know that it can seem scary, and it was definitely scary going through it. But at the end of the day, like, I wouldn't change this for the world. If I had to think of like going through all of that to get the breast that I've always wanted, I would 100% do that versus what I had before. And I feel like it all just really affects your confidence level too. Like, my confidence really grew as well. So it's no easy decision, of course, to have a breast augmentation or any surgery for that matter. Definitely weigh the pros and the cons and do what's right for you and your body. I'm so happy I did it. And like I said, I wouldn't change it for the world. If you guys have any more questions on that, like more specifically, let me know. And I'm more than happy to answer. You guys know I'm an open book. These two questions are so good and I'm gonna group them together. So one is tips on saving money when you have a shopping addiction. And the second is how do you balance your spending? So shopping money versus essentials and all like that sort of stuff. So these are definitely two really, really great questions. First and foremost for the shopping addiction one, I would say know your limit. I would never, ever, ever let myself go into debt over shopping and clothes. So I really think that if you set a budget, you really need it to stick to it. You cannot impulse buy. Like take for instance, if you know your kryptonite is Lululemon, do not go on the website, do not go on the store, because you will always convince yourself you need to have that. You know, like that's a part of having an addiction, is you always make excuses for everything to just get that item and make yourself feel better and not guilty about it. So I feel like you really need to like remove yourself from the equation. Don't put yourself into like that sort of position. Also, if you end up, you know, making the excuses and you're like, oh no, I need this for that, da da da, whatever it may be, things add up so fast. So really try to like restrain yourself as well. And going more into the balance of everything, I definitely have mentioned that I'm just a very data-driven person. I love to visually see my money, I guess. It's really important for me to organize and track my spending. I need to know what categories everything is going towards, how I'm kind of spending my money every single month. It's like I kind of do my own little retrospective every month. As I look at the categories, I see what has fluctuated month over month, what is increasing, and if there's ways that I can pull back a little bit in some areas as well. So for me, I do have a spreadsheet that I look at every single month, if not once a week or sometimes daily, that tracks all my spending. I also set budgets for myself so I know what my income is. I know that I want to save between 20 to 30% a month. I have a certain percentage for my bills, and then I have leftover money too. So that leftover fund money is what I spend within, and I try not to go over that limit. If I do, there has to be a good reason, aka a vacation or something. But also to that point, I think that it's really good to have a goal in mind. And this maybe goes back to like the shopping addiction problem too. I feel like having a goal really helps to create structure in your mind a little bit more. So whether that is you just want to have a more of a cushion for emergencies, you want to save up to buy a house, a car, go on vacation, whatever it might be, I feel like if you have something to look forward to, it'll help you to restrain from overspending because you really want that thing, you know? So I feel like that's really helpful motto to live by. I'm not an expert by any means, but I hope that that helped and it addressed your questions. Ooh, what item would you say you prefer from Lulu? Keep rocking it, girl. XO. Thank you, girl. You're so sweet. This is a hard question. That's actually kind of funny. I don't know, like prefer. I can give you a list of like my favorites. There's never just one item that you know that you prefer, but there's definitely items that are absolutely my favorite. So let's see here. Anything from the Align collection is my favorite. So whether that's the Align pants and the crop, the 21 inch, or the 25 inch, the shorts and the 6 inch, or the Align joggers. Love those so, so, so much. The Ready to Rulus, you really can't go wrong with that. The All Yours tees, so whether that's just like the regular oversized one, the cropped one, or the tank top, love those. Those are classics for me too. For sports bras, I mean, I would say Ebb to Train, Ebb to Street, the Energy bra, but the regular one, not the long line, the Flow Y bra, and then most recently, the In Alignment Racerback. Ugh, I'm good. I'm obsessed with that bra so much. I want them to come out with it in so many other colors. For jackets, I would say the Always Effortless jacket. Is that what it's called? If it's not, I'll put it on the screen, the correct name for it. But I have that in 3 colors. That is an amazing, just everyday sort of jacket. I even layer like sweatshirts underneath it. Super, super good. And then for shorts, it's funny, I'm so like undecided on a lot of shorts, but the shorts that I do love, they don't have them all the time on their website, but during the summer they typically do. It's like the choose a side, like reversible shorts. Those ones fit phenomenally. They are not lined. The Soft Ambition shorts, those are amazing for more just casual athleisure. The Spring Break shorts, I don't think that those are currently on their website, but I feel like they come and go. Those are amazing too. And then of course like the Align shorts. So that really just covers a lot of different areas, but those are the items that I prefer from Lulu. Is vaxxed and waxed the summer 2021 motto? Well, duh, is it not? This is the summer that we are gonna have a summer. I'm saying it now, you got to. Not a question, but I'm so proud of how much your platform has grown, XOXO. I know who you are, you're the sweetest. Thank you so much, I love you. Thinking about moving to Seattle, any recommendations on where to live for a single early 30s professional? It's actually really funny, I've lived in Seattle my whole damn life. This is the only place that I've lived, but I've never actually lived in Seattle. I've only lived in the suburbs outside of Seattle. Apologies if you can hear Oliver eating. I'm sitting next to where he eats. So from my perspective, I have a few different options. For one, if you want to live in the city, like in the city of Seattle, I would highly recommend Queen Anne, Fremont, Ballard type of areas. I love visiting those areas. I feel like it's definitely a range of between people that are like 21 to like mid 30s. Of course, there's older people there too, but it's just like a really fun environment. Lots of places to eat, lots of places to go out to. When I was younger, those were always the places that I would go into the city to go to too. God, so good. And if you want to live outside of the city, like more in the suburb areas, I love the East Side personally. The Bellevue, Kirkland, Woodinville, Redmond area is super great too. Maybe Bellevue, because then you can have a mix of like suburban life, but a little bit of city life too with all like the restaurants and stuff. Best AM PM serums you recommend for combo oily skin? That is a really good question. I haven't strayed too far from my skincare routine in a few years. A serum that I absolutely love is one that is a mandelic acid serum. It's an AHA, but it's also a very delicate type of AHA, so it's really suited for those that have like sensitive skins, even ones that have acne and stuff like that. So that's definitely a really good one. I, over the years, have become very sensitive to lactic glycolic sort of acids, so mandelic acid has been like a gold mine find for me. It's really transformed my skin and it helps it to like really glow and keep it healthy and hydrated as well. So I would really recommend that, and I use that in the evening. And one that I use for both the morning and the evening time is a growth factor serum or gel. That one is super reparative for your skin. It helps with fine lines, wrinkles, collagen, you name it. So any serum like that, that's like a reparative serum, or ones that have like peptides or something, I would highly recommend those. I recently just got a vitamin C serum, but I'm still testing it out. But if it's good, I can report back and let you guys know. But vitamin C has been really hard for me to find a good one, or my skin doesn't react. I was just trying one a couple weeks ago and it reacted so bad. I'm still trying to recover from it. So I'm still on the hunt for like a really, really good vitamin C serum, but I'll keep you posted on this new one that I just got that I'm so excited to try out. Oof, this is a good question. Have you always had a healthy relationship with food and exercise? Love your videos, thank you. I would say for the most part, yes. I've always had a pretty healthy relationship with food and exercise. Have I ever second-guessed my appearance and my confidence level? Absolutely, I still do today. But when it comes to, say, food more specifically, I've never abused it. I've never overeaten or skipped eating either. Granted, thank you to my parents for genetics. I'm just not someone that's prone to being overweight either. I definitely have like my skinny fat time, and I had that like in college and everything. But I think like anything else, if you realize, hey, I'm out of shape, then you just work on getting in shape, you know? But I never really went on any diets or done anything like that. I'd actually say like in the recent years, let's say like the last 6 years, especially when I started going through a lot of issues with my skin, it wasn't until after 25 that I really dealt with acne. And then of course, at the same time, I started dealing with melasma. So I really took a look inside out, and everything around me changed. I really took the time to learn about food and the ingredients that go into food, skincare, and the ingredients that go into all your products, even dish soap, hand soap, laundry detergent, like you name it. I just really tried to be more clean and non-toxic with everything around me. It's actually really funny because even like before 5 years ago, like I would eat probably fast food like once a week, twice a week sometimes. And then now it's like something that I second guess. I'm like, is that really like the best for me? But of course, I allow myself to give into cravings. Like, I have such a sweet tooth. I don't know, I think for me it's just like a lot of balance, but I feel like I've always had a pretty healthy relationship with like food and exercise the exact same way too. I've always been pretty passionate about exercise and fitness. I've always been a part of a gym for as long as I could remember. Like, even my mom and I, we would have a membership and we would go to like 24-hour fitness. And I even took fitness and health classes throughout college because I just felt like that stuff was so interesting to learn, and just how all the different muscle groups are and the best way to work out too. I think what I will say is that when you get older, a lot of other people's opinions and feeling like you're being peer pressured really go out the door. I feel like as I've gotten older, I've really come to know myself, what I like, what I don't like, what I'm not gonna put up with too. And so I don't let other people's opinions and views really affect me. And if you can start to learn that early on, more the power to you as you get older too. It's funny to think of because I love who I am, where I'm at, and all of the life lessons that I've gone through. Like, I wouldn't change anything for the world. I don't regret anything that has happened in my life. It's just funny to like look back and think of like how young, naive, and all like those sort of things you were, but like where you're at now, it's like, damn, killing it, you know, mentally. I feel like I'm in a really, really good spot. Age, I tell ya, it's not the devil as a lot of people think. You actually do become wiser. Favorite clothing brand of all time? Why would you do this to me? I can't even answer that. I have top favorite brands, which you guys know of by now. I mean, Lululemon, Aritzia. I love a Goldie. I love Nike. I love Adidas. I'm probably missing some. The IKEA dresser. It holds everything beautifully. Your thoughts on quality? I've actually had that IKEA dresser for a very long time now. I would say like 8 years or so. It's in perfect condition. It's like I just got it yesterday. It holds up really, really, really well. It's super heavy to move too, so surprisingly, it's pretty good quality. All right, this question. I guess I've avoided it long enough. So, plans to get married and or have kids? Any plans for kids in the future? Let's see if I can be short and precise about this. Do I have plans to get married? Maybe someday. Do I have plans to have kids? Maybe someday. It's actually very interesting because I feel like 2020 was rough for a lot of people, right? But I feel like 2020 also let me slow down, look internally of like what I really want out of life. And I feel like at least for me and my whole life, I've been doing things that society has been wanting me to do, you know? I need to graduate high school, I need to go to college, and then you need to get married, you need to have kids, you need to do things in a certain order. And I feel like last year I've really like looked internally and it's like, well, do I want to get married? Do I want to have kids? Is that something that I really want in my life? Because the thought of it, if I'm going to be quite frank, kind of stresses me out. Like, I don't feel like I'm ready to have kids by any means, but I also feel like the clock is ticking, right? So I've kind of allowed myself to back off of the pressure that I've put on myself because of society. So on the kids front, like, I'll do what I need to on that front if I need to freeze eggs or whatever, if it's gonna be farther out. But realistically, I'm not in any rush. I think it's something that I just need to think more about, if that's something that I want in my life. And if I do, when I would want to have that in my life, if I was even able to, you know what I mean? There's a lot of things that might be against you in that regard too. And I think in the same regard, I have similar thoughts about marriage too. Like, I'm in an amazing relationship of 4.5 years. Does getting married really define my relationship any more than what it is now? How is my commitment to the relationship gonna change just because I have a piece of paper? Do you know what I mean? And obviously I'm just being direct and I'm just like sharing my thoughts with it, but who knows, you know? I don't have a time plan on any of these things. Will I get married? Like, sure, maybe one day if I do, it's probably gonna be like an elopement or like a really, really small wedding just between like the two of us and maybe some like immediate family. But yeah, I don't know. We'll see. Only time will tell on both of those topics. So I think that this video is gonna be super long already, so I'm gonna end the questions here. Feel free to keep sending me questions. I can start to bank them and we can do another Q&A another month or so if you guys have more questions. But I have to say, I'm very flattered that you guys wanna get to know me more. I thank you guys so much for subscribing and watching me every single week and being a part of this journey. I absolutely wouldn't be here without you guys. So I love you guys so much. I really hope that you guys enjoyed this video. Make sure you're subscribed and follow me on Instagram before you go, and I'll see you in a couple of days in my next video. Bye guys, I love you.